In this video, we're revealing how to invest in stocks for complete beginners and how doing this literally changed my life forever, Angel. Hey guys, how's it going? My name is Mike Vasile. Welcome to this video. Before we actually begin, I remind you that several spots have opened up for this week's free workshop, where it's the fastest and easiest way to make money online. Sign up for it in the link below.
We literally have a 62-year-old woman go from zero to 160 grand profit in 90 days, so check it out now.
So as of recently, I got really excited about investing in stocks. Why? Because like everybody else, I want to reach that ultimate financial freedom. But little did I know that everything that I was ever taught when I was younger was completely wrong when it came to creating financial freedom for myself. And I wanted to learn how to, for example, invest in stocks, but granted, no one ever taught me that. They don't teach me in school. My parents didn't teach me. I just thought my entire life, I just had to work a job and, you know, for example, get a 401k and then maybe retire when I'm 65 years old. And I just didn't know that. But then guess what happened? I literally got into business, got into success, built a business that not only went from, for example, zero to 8 grand in 30 days to zero to 5 grand in 30 days, 1.6 million that first year, but I started gaining excess capital in my life where I was like, well, how the heck do I learn how to invest in this? So I kid you not, over the past year, I went like deep in the investment category. And I learned how to invest not only from, like, for example, really successful people that I interview here in Bali, like this 11-year-old girl that turned on $30 million that I interviewed on my podcast, or this guy that makes $1 million from a profit, but I've been just studying the granddaddy of them all, which is like Charlie Munger and Warren Buffett. And that kind of like leads me to the first step in learning how to invest money in stocks is, if you're going to learn how to invest, you might as well learn from people that have what you want. Learning from your uncle that maybe tried stock trading, or, you know, that guy that's talking about YouTube, or like, you know, like the stocks to invest on YouTube, or maybe like you're on Reddit and you're looking at Wall Street bets and you're seeing what other people are going and, for example, investing in. Probably not the best thing when you literally have people like Warren Buffett make all of his wealth from investing in the right businesses, right? So before we actually begin, this isn't financial advice. I'm not a financial advisor. Of course, investing in stocks and business is risky, but what I ended up doing is I realized, okay, because it's risky and because I'm not smart and no one else, even though everyone's giving me advice, they don't have the results that I want. I have to first begin with the people that have the results. So one of the first things that I did is literally read everything about Warren Buffett and Charlie Munger, because if you want to get good at investing in stocks, that's like you trying to lose weight and get a six pack by taking advice from someone that is like fat and obese. They never have the results that you want. If you're trying to learn how to, you know, make money and invest in stocks by literally reading Reddit or looking at YouTubers that are talking about what stocks they're picking, it almost doesn't make sense when you literally have like the Michael Jordan of investing in stocks, have all these books and all these videos and learning directly from them. I think what changed for me was when I stopped looking at, for example, YouTubers telling me how to invest in stocks, which is kind of like ironic because I'm kind of like making this video on how I invest in stocks, and instead start studying really, really smart people like Warren Buffett and Charlie Munger, right? So that's the first step. Read all these books. One of the biggest things that helped me was this book, because he literally talked about his lessons learned in the past 30 years, the mistakes and the failures that he made in investing in businesses. And you want to ask yourself, if you're going to invest in stocks, would you rather, you know, lose your own money or learn from other people's failures, right? You look like a lot smarter than, for example, I was, and I would rather like learn from other people's failures. Does that make sense? Now, the second step that you understand, when you invest in stocks and in just companies, is behind every single stock is actually a business. Is a business that cash flows. And you know, I remember I was like reading, I think it was Monish Pabrai, who's also like has this big fund as well. And he said the fact that he was an entrepreneur made him a better investor. And the fact that he was an investor made him a better entrepreneur. So I started actually looking at that because I thought investing was like a separate skill that, you know, I just only smart people had. Well, little did I know that investing was very similar to business. And when I started looking at the things that I invest in, similar to like a business, you start really making better choices. Does that make sense? Like my investment like mindset that I learned from Warren Buffett allowed me to build like a new business now, like anywhere from like, now we're pulling in 1700 to like, even like yesterday was 3 grand, and today was even like a lot higher in like this new business that I created. But because of that mindset with my business, I'm now learning how to actually value other companies and projects that I want to invest in, which leads me to understanding that when you invest in a stock, you're essentially investing in ownership in a business that you want to take part of, right? Which leads me to the third step on how to invest in stocks that I've learned from literally reading this book, right? Don't take my word for it. Take some guy who's worth billions of dollars. And that is, you want to invest in companies that you see being around 10, 20, 30, 40 years from now, right? One of the things that I learned, because you know, earlier on when I made my initial money and then lost it all, right? Like when I made, for example, zero to 1.6 million with about 30% profit margins, I literally took all that money and lost it all because I wanted to go and invest in the, like the sexiest business. Like I wanted to be like that investor that I was like, oh yeah, look at all my startups and stuff like that. And that's like really hard, because the thing about what I've learned studying the past 30 years of his life is things change every single year. Much less every single 5 years, much less every single decade. And companies that existed like 5 years ago do not exist now. Most businesses do not succeed 10 years in the future. And the way that he invests in businesses is he literally like invests in businesses until like he basically dies. Like he tries never selling his positions in stocks because of the fact that he just loves the business. He's willing to invest in good businesses at fair prices. So he literally values, like for example, how a business is and the potential they could go. That's like how he, for example, invested in Geico, not because it was a stock, but it was a company that was undervalued that still had so much potential. Or See's Candy, or for example, Coca-Cola. All these things he invested in with this long-term vision of investing for the long term. Which is really, really interesting, that philosophy of just really wondering, if you're not gonna hold on to it and invest in it for 10 plus years, you don't want to hold onto the stock for 10 minutes. It's a really actually good lesson in life. If you don't want to do something for the next 10 years, don't even do it for the next 10 seconds. If I don't want to, for example, be with this woman, or say like even in dating, because you know everyone like has that part in their life. If I don't see myself being with this woman for the next 10 years, don't be with her for the next like 10 minutes, right? And this is something that like is even making sense, for example, the dating mind, because there's so many times I'm like, man, if I could even just be with that girl, my life would be so much better. And then I would be with her and then she'd have like all this trauma and it would be like projecting out on me and I'd be like, oh my God, I'd feel like I'd go crazy. And then I would just like we would just uncouple, right? When granted, you literally see someone you'd be with for 10 plus years, you're like, okay, well, I would be with her for more than 10 minutes. Or even like business partnerships, right? If you can't see yourself working with someone for the next 10 years, don't even waste another 10 minutes, because you're literally just gonna waste a lot of time and energy and effort. And the way that he invests in stocks is he's like, okay, can I see myself investing in this for the next 10 years where I know this business will exist? And if you really think about it, it makes you make better decisions than your stocks. Oh, am I betting in this stock because, you know, I saw a YouTube video where they went all in and they YOLO'd on this like one, like, you know, Marcus Theater stock or this AMC stock or this, you know, GameStop stock, right? Or do I see this business literally growing year after year after year after year? The next thing that I learned on learning how to invest in the right stocks is letting compound interest actually do its place. Because this is a problem with most people investing in stocks. They do too much day trading. So even though, for example, like they might make 20%, 30%, 50%, 100% on their money on some crazy bet, it's not consistent. You know, their percentage is up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down. And they're constantly selling. And every single time they sell, even though I'm not a tax advisor, I'm not a tax consultant, this is financial advice, they have to pay taxes on it, right? And with all that risk, even though they make a lot and you know the good days, you don't know their bad days. You don't know how much money they lost, right? But you could see when you chase crazy returns like 80%, 20%, right? Unless if you're paid advertisement where the return is like a lot higher, but you have to learn a specific skill. Warren Buffett has literally just been doing 20% return every single year, right? 20% return, which doesn't look like that much on the grand scheme of things, right? His return, if you literally see it, if you literally have like money and time, ever since like 1960s, right? Warren Buffett has been returning only 20% every single year. The crazy thing that ends up happening though is after a while that starts compounding like crazy, which you could see right here. When Warren Buffett was 65, he was worth about 1 to 3 billion, right? Most of his wealth, his like 70 plus billion wealth, came after the age of 65. Why? It's because he was willing to wait out and invest in good projects that have a good tail end, and this is more tax efficient. Remember, I'm not a tax advisor, I'm not a tax consultant. Because he's holding it, right? He literally only has to go ahead and, you know, really have a huge tax bill when he goes and sells his position, which potentially could be never if he goes and invests it in the long run. Compared to people that take their profits and do a lot of trading, they have to pay per every single transaction that they make, which is why, you know, a lot of the reasons why a lot of people fail in investing is because they don't have tax efficient strategies to go ahead and invest their wealth. They're like, oh, I want to make money now. I want to make money now, because their time horizon is only in 1 year increments. But remember the previous question that we talked about on how to invest in stocks. When you think in 10-year increments, you make better decisions. You don't make dumb decisions. Does that make sense? And what Charlie Munger says is you literally want to focus on actions that have this tail end, that, for example, compounds over time, right? You don't want to go ahead and day trade, right? Because if you day trade, you can make like 100 grand this year, but the next year you can make 20 grand. But the next year after that, you can make 300 grand, but then the next year could make 30 grand. I don't know about you, but I do not enjoy a life where my business is like dependent on my skill level, how good I am, as well as, for example, what's going on with the marketplace and other people's stupidity. I don't want that. I would rather almost look like I'm not making anything for several years, and then like it going and getting better and easier year after year. And that's literally how investing and business should be. It should get easier and easier, because when it comes to patience and looking at 10 to 20 year increments, most people don't have that patience, which is perfectly fine. Because like I said, if you look at a day trader that maybe had crazier returns some years, right? You don't know exactly the long-term aspect of things. He could essentially lose all of his wealth in the 20 year time frame. Right, but when you look at this moment, you're like, oh my God, this person made 300% return on his investment, while Warren Buffett is a loser and only made 20% return. Of course, when you compare people to that specific time in that instance, right, like Warren Buffett could look like the loser. But that's not the game of investing. The game of investing is, in your lifetime, will you make more money or will you lose it all? When I made zero to 1.6 million that first year, guess what ended up happening? Because I wasn't patient, right? This is Warren Buffett's 20%. I literally started with like less than $1,000, right? And that $1,000 turned into, what is this? 1.6 million. So that's like a huge return, right? That's like nearly, what is that? 1,000x return in my money in terms of like sales to money that I've spent, right? But guess what? I got like 1,000x return. I went like that, right? And then because of that moment, if you looked at the return, oh wow, like Mike got 1,000x return. Warren Buffett only got 20%. I want to do Mike's business that he did in 2015. No one saw what happened afterwards, which I lost it all because I was stupid, right? And when you look at this, it's a no-brainer. This person is still above water. I am not. And this is something you guys got to realize when it comes to like investing in stocks, is like, if you do not have that long-term play, if you don't have that long-term vision of where you see the stocks that you want to go and invest in the next 10, 20, 30 years, that's very, very hard to go ahead and succeed in it. Does that make sense? Another thing that I learned when it comes to, for example, investing in the right stock, you want to go and invest in stocks that have a moat around it. What do I actually mean by that? It should be harder and harder and harder for competitors to go ahead and build, you know, like to go against you. That's the reason why, for example, he invests in, you know, like Coca-Cola. So Coca-Cola, the reason why is it's very hard for people to go ahead and compete against Coca-Cola because of their distribution network. And they built it ever since like the late 1800s. Right? So they have this crazy infrastructure where it's very hard to go against, okay? Same way why he invested in Geico. The reason why is because all of that extra money that they had in insurance called float, it literally was the thing that allowed them to stay competitive and to kind of also even earn a return from like their float, right? Because of the fact that they had so much money already in place. And what you gotta see, not just in like stocks, but remember, stocks are businesses. Every single time you own a business, every single year, what he talks to all of his operators that build each one of their businesses. If this is, you know, for example, the castle, and the castle is literally the business, every single year you want to go and widen the moat. Every single year you want to put alligators in this moat. Every single year you want to make this moat bigger so it protects the competitors from coming in and trying to take your castle with their swords, right? It literally prevents more people coming in. And same way with business, why you don't want to chase always the easiest business that's free to get into because anybody can get into and competitors will destroy you. You want to go and choose the businesses that you could learn how to build a moat around. Like for example, my moat is very simple. Like my moat, if you can see this, I have a product that someone else creates. I have like literally three videos I make every single day to that product. I have even YouTube ads that I'm making to this product. I have Facebook ads going to this product. I'm ranking on Google, I'm ranking on Pinterest, all going to this product. As you can see, what's my moat? My moat's in the marketing and in my partnerships with the product creator. Where no matter what happens in the world, this will always change if the world changes, or this will always change when a new platform arises. And just because I have to focus on two things that are widening my moat, That's the reason why my business was able to grow exponentially, for example, this year from a business that wasn't existing just like 12 months ago, right? It's the exact same thing with businesses in general. When you invest in businesses, you want to see, okay, will this business get better every single year? Like, for example, Tesla, like Amazon, like Apple, like Microsoft, like any one of these companies. Or can something drastically happen where it could literally ruin all of your chances of success? Which leads me to the last and final thing, which I think is the most important thing, and that's sticking to your circle of competence. And that's where you get your unique advantage. Here's what I learned about that. Like, so for example, Warren Buffett and Charlie Munger, the people that like run Berkshire Hathaway, right? They were really close friends with Andy Grove, who's like the leader at Intel, as well as, for example, Bill Gates, who was, you know, for example, Microsoft. And Warren Buffett had the ability to go ahead and invest in those startups because of that connection and relationship that he had. But the only thing is, he didn't. Now, why didn't he do it, even though he was friends with them? He really liked Bill Gates. They're like close friends, but yet he didn't want to invest in Microsoft because it wasn't his core competency. What does Warren Buffett invest in? He invests in like Dairy Queen, in Coca-Cola, in, for example, Wells Fargo, in Bank of America, in like old school businesses like See's Candy, right? Like these businesses that like as actual product that people eat or he drinks, right? Or it could be like a warehouse of, you know, like furniture in Nebraska, right? He invests in like these things that he can actually understand with his mind because he's a lot older. He doesn't invest in Bitcoin. He doesn't invest in technology companies because he says he's not the smartest in that. And he doesn't want to invest in something where there's literally people who spent 10 to 20 to 30 years building their zone of genius in that industry, because it's like a four-year-old doing a boxing fight with like a professional boxer. It just doesn't make any sense. This happened to me all the time. You know, I remember making a lot of money and I'm like, oh, I want to go into that industry. I don't know anything about that industry, but I want to try. And I want to invest my money into that industry where I don't know anyone. And I did it and I lost a bunch of money because I didn't stick to my zone of genius. What Charlie Munger talks about and Warren Buffett talks about is they're not smart. They're only smart in spots and they stay in the spot. So you literally have something that you're good at. This is you. This is your personality. This is your characteristics. This is your unique traits about you. And this is the rest of the opportunity in the world, right? This is like the stocks, you know, like the tech stocks, the AI stocks, whatever stock that you name it, it's out here in the world. What you need to focus on is investing in projects that are you really good at. And same how you invest in stocks, like how you invest in businesses, that's literally what I do in my business. Like for example, for me, even though I like understand certain stocks, right? I don't necessarily, that's like not my zone of genius. Like for example, AI, artificial technology, like certain crypto projects. I don't know much about that stuff because I'm not the smartest person in the world. And the dumbest thing that I could do is leave my circle of genius to go and chase like crazy returns when everyone else is doing that. What instead they talk about is you really need to take inventory on who you are. What's your personality? What are your character traits? What do you enjoy learning about that wouldn't even be a job if all you could spend is just reading on things about that? For me, as weird as it is, it's like online digital businesses that are some types of creative, so like YouTube ads or Facebook ads, or like content-based businesses where I rank on a search engine like Google, YouTube, Facebook, you know, any Pinterest, right? That's what I realized I needed to focus in on, because I know I could get more return in those zone of geniuses where like every single time we spend a dollar, we're making like $3 back. You can't get that returns. Like for example, if I invest like in a See's Candy, like I can't be like a Warren Buffett, right? I don't have, you know, that long-term horizon because he's just so much smarter than me. But I know I can spend a dollar and get $3 back with like, for example, advertising, because that's what I ended up getting good at. That was my core competency. For other people, it might not be the case. Some people might love, for example, e-commerce, right? And because of that, they should start looking at, well, what are other e-commerce businesses that they could see them existing for the next 10, 20, 30, 40 years? Or some people like, for example, software. What are some software companies based off of the leaders that are running those companies that you could literally see existing for the next 10, 20, 30 years? Asking yourself these questions before investing in stocks is crucial. And like I said, this isn't financial advice. I'm not a financial advisor. But if you want to learn faster and easier ways to get higher returns, like how these people went from zero to 30 grand a month in 5 to 8 weeks, then sign up for this week's free workshop below, as well as check out this video on this podcast right here. Hope you subscribe. Love you guys. See you guys later. Woo!